based on their antibodies and immunities to their descendants. With each generation, Europeans gained stronger and stronger immune systems, which meant that formerly devastating diseases were no longer quite so deadly. So when the Europeans brought these diseases to the world, exposing the population whose ancestors had no opportunity to build up those same immunities, the result was devastating. But there's a part of the story that might strike some people as a gaping hole. Why weren't the Europeans having the same problem? They too were in a new land encountering new people. Why weren't the colonists dying of the American diseases? Well, the answer is cities. Europeans lived in densely packed cities, which were breeding grounds for infection. Another thing that we've seen pretty darn clearly in 2020. I don't know if you've heard about this one. It looks like a lot of people are still missing the memo, but big gatherings of people all packed together in a tight space are one of the easiest ways to spread a virus. Go figure. Social distancing starts to get a whole lot harder when you're all packed together like sardines. And all of that gets compounded far worse when you don't have modern conveniences like plumbing and clean water. If you want an indication of how big a problem water contamination was during this time, it took until 1535 to finally prohibit people from dumping their excrement into the River Thames of London. Yeah, they had to pass a law outlawing you from dumping your poop into the water that ran through its most populous city. Reports from the time say that the water ran black. Really makes you want to reconsider that river being property. Now, all of these factors combined make European cities a breeding ground for all kinds of horrible diseases. Well, America, meanwhile, with its lack of densely populated cities, stood in stark contrast. And thanks, indigenous people of North America had no plagues. All of that is a fascinating and frankly tragic looking history, but what relevance does it have in Minecraft? Well, understanding the history of diseases and plagues in the real world becomes a lot easier for us to understand how this might happen in the fictional world of Minecraft. Let's just assume for a minute that there is a zombie plague floating around in the air of Minecraft's overworld and man. We don't know how it would have started or why. Maybe it was the result of experiments trying to resurrect the dead, as we talked about in the previous theory. Maybe it was somehow tied to the appearance of the Wither. Who knows? But let's just say that it happened. Well, in those early days, it would be good. Those who managed to avoid being turned into zombies would still have to deal with the menace of being attacked by the undead. It could very well be that the zombie plague was responsible for wiping out the overworld's population. The reason
say having researched this theory was a huge mistake on my part. While the desert might be lacking in quality, it is teeming with lore, filled with subtle game design decisions that give us details about the long-forgotten ancient world of this game, and connecting in with a lot of the theories that we've had since the earliest days of the channel. In short, the desert is where everything in the lost history of Minecraft's world began, which is why it is a shame that I'm only starting to cover it now. So I hope you're thirsty, theorists. Thirsty for a nice, cold, cool glass of knowledge, that is. Because today is all about cats, creepers, and desert temples. Oh my. But first, just a quick note here to say that brand new TheoryWare is available right now. All of that is my little Minecraft lore series, which I've been building on for the better part of 2 years, began with the premise that the world of Minecraft was once home to an ancient civilization of builders who left behind the structures that we see today. Over time, and many episodes of Game Theory, we've been able to show that this ancient race was obsessed with preserving life, leading to experiments with soul sand that resulted in the creation of the Wither, alongside other mobs that might also be made from souls. And while I think I've made a pretty solid case for all that so far, today we're going to examine a piece of evidence in the game that is by far the strongest argument for this being the true history of the Minecraft universe. One absolutely intended by the game developers. And not just me, you know, doing that thing that I always do where I insert lore where lore was never meant to go. So what exactly am I talking about? Well, if we examine the blocks of the temples that spawn randomly into the desert biome, we see a symbol that looks like a real-world hieroglyph, which, in ancient Egypt, was the symbol of life, the Ankh. And this should immediately strike you as odd. The world of Minecraft is entirely fictional, and largely a blank slate, where we can layer in whatever adventures we want to have in this world. And yet, for some reason, this is our one instance of a real-world symbol being used in the Minecraft universe. I mean, when the game's developers were designing these structures, they didn't have to use any symbol. It's not like jungle temples or underwater temples have any sort of real-world symbology. So that's already an odd little outlier about these temples, but beyond that, if they really felt the need to use hieroglyphics, there are dozens of iconic ones that they could have chosen, like the Eye of Horus, which, if you ask me, is much more iconic. Get it? Iconic? I hate myself so much. But instead, they decided to go with the Ankh, the symbol of life. What's more, the Ankh didn't just symbolize life. It was a symbol of the idea of the continuity of life. The ancient Egyptians were famous for mummifying their dead and then building elaborate, beautiful, and massive tombs for them. All of this was based on the idea that what we now think of as death wasn't the end of life, but rather just one step on their journey into the afterlife. Hence the need to preserve the physical body even after all signs of life leave it. That is roughly what the Ankh stood for. Eternal life. Life after death. Which, if you ask me, ties in pretty neatly with the theory that I've been crafting about these Minecraft buildings. An ancient civilization obsessed with life and finding a way to conquer death? Check. Building a bunch of ancient structures that have endured to the present day, leaving archaeologists like us trying to piece together how these ancient civilizations operated? Check again. And this is just scratching the surface. The more that we dig into the desert biome, the more we start to get a clearer picture of what kinds of projects those ancient buildings were working on.
Blue moon light sky. A light here with as much flavor, should I say.
Oh yeah, we're talking about those guys. One of gaming's most iconic enemies, the creeper. One of the first things that every player learns about the desert pyramids is, well, gotta be careful, because the people who built them left behind some traps. Traps in the form of TNT. In fact, desert pyramids are one of the very few places in the game that you can actually find TNT. You find TNT near the ocean by looting buried treasure and shipwrecks, so the only places that you may be finding TNT in the world itself are in the desert pyramids or in certain woodland mansions. So depending on that woodland mansion stuff, we can come back to that in a few minutes. Now, the desert temple TNT is notable because TNT has a very specific connection to the creeper. Obviously, TNT and the creeper are both very explosive. They both make a similar hissing sound. Also notice that crafting TNT requires gunpowder, and one of the few reliable sources of gunpowder is killing creepers. What you might not know about the creeper is that they are literally made of TNT. No joke, in the official Minecraft book, the Mabisiary
Mm-hmm.